Mason County is located on the Olympic Peninsula and borders the Puget Sound. It is home to the Olympic National Park, and lumber has been the county's primary industry for over a century. Mason is a rural county with a population of less than 61,000 residents. Approximately 17% of the population lives in poverty. Mason County is remarkably interconnected, with many local programs and services available to assist those who are attempting to break out of poverty. I came to Mason County in 2011 as an AmeriCorps volunteer to help United Way develop the Asset Building Coalition of Mason County, and I have since become the coalition's coordinating director. During the last 4 years, I've been a financial mentor, and I have taught financial empowerment classes to hundreds of people throughout the county, the majority of whom are women living in poverty. Through extensive research and experience, I have found that it is easier for women to fall into poverty, and it is much more difficult for women to climb out. Through interviews with women who are or have experienced poverty and the professionals who are helping them, this documentary explores the barriers that keep women from obtaining self-sufficiency in Mason County. What is the cycle of poverty? The cycle of poverty is a phenomenon where poor families become trapped in poverty for generations, resulting from limited or no access to critical resources, such as a lack of education, which can lead to a lack of training or skills. And this can lead to a lack of employment opportunities. And a lack of employment opportunities can lead to a lack of finances. And a lack of finances often leads back to a lack of education. This cycle perpetuates itself and can have drastic effects on a person, such as addiction, shattered health, family breakup, homelessness, transportation issues, isolation, and even early death. The cycle continues until effective intervention breaks the cycle. An example of this is breaking through the cycle with education intervention.
So a big question remains, how do we break the cycle of poverty in Mason County?
What I see is the way out of the cycle of poverty, not just temporary, I've been having a really hard time and I need the safety net, but you know, the generational poverty is education, really, because if you can't move forward in your life with your family and your career and that sort of stuff, if you don't have the knowledge and the skills and the self-confidence that knowing what you're talking about brings, then you stay stuck.
In my experience for many years, I learned the poverty in females, especially in females, come for three different things in life. Could be domestic violence, for example, drug abuse, mental health, and the biggest one, most I would say, is lack of education. We're talking about education, not just in a way to say academic level education. We're talking education about life skills.
We know from lots of research that it's a passed down kind of thing. So if you were taught a certain way of being a family, you teach that to your children. So if we can break in somewhere and say, no, you know, don't treat your child as you were treated, I think that's a big thing for women.
One of the things that we see here at the shelter a lot is what we like to call generational poverty or the cycle of poverty. And what that means to us is that we see families, in fact, we see families come through the shelter even that have generations of families come through the shelter. We see the effects that it has on their lives. We see how the challenges that families have breaking that cycle of poverty, coming out of poverty, and there are a lot of barriers to that.
I'm Terry Bass. 69 years old, homeless. Can't find a job because of my age. It's either I'm too old or I'm overqualified. I've done 23 3/4 years in the military. I'm a retired vet. And that kind of holds me back in some cases. Finding a place to live and everything, it's tough, you know, and sleeping on the concrete's not the best thing in the world. Plenty of people, you know, get help, and because I'm not drug and alcohol, I've got a clean background and no felonies, no nothing. I mean, I've had background checks done and I'm clean. They'd say I'm nobody. So, you know, but I can't get no help.
Hi, my name is Karen and I'm 32 years old, and I guess I've always lived a life of poverty, and you know, it was just kind of the way I grew up with my parents. We always lived in low-income neighborhoods, always just lived off of state assistance. I never once seen my mom hold a job in my entire life. My dad worked for a little bit with his dad, but after that I never seen my dad work either. And nobody in my family ever went to college. Nobody in my family ever talked about going to college. It just wasn't something that we did.
I'm suffering from a traumatic brain injury, car wreck. I was in 99, and I'm never going to be back to normal, the doctors tell me.
Hi, I'm Chris. I live on the Skokomish Indian Reservation. I saw a friend the other day, and I told her how my husband left me with all the bills. And anyways, so it moved back at the middle of February. And I moved back in with my parents. And my girlfriend said, isn't it great that we can come back home, you know? And she was right.
What do you see as a major barrier for women in poverty?
I think that probably the major barrier would be the generational poverty and the not really knowing there is an out or knowing any other way of life, and thinking that it's okay that people have to live like that. And for the rest of us, the rest of our society, we should be absolutely screaming, it isn't okay, and let's fix it.
One of my biggest barriers was always childcare. You know, the first 2 years of college, you know, I was able to get childcare through the state, which jumped through all their hoops, and of course I was really grateful for it and for everything that I got, but I had to get really, really resourceful, you know, working student jobs, and the only student loan I ever got was so that I could pay for childcare.
The one problem we have in our community is transportation. Because if we get a job for this female, for example, how are they going to go to work?
Like, my problem is I'm staying with some friends right now on a couch, I'm couch surfing, and they live out of town, but the bus runs, there's a bus route, but my bus doesn't get me into town until late. One of the church groups that's really good and really supportive of the homeless people, St. Edward's Catholic Church, has been doing a breakfast program here at the Community Lifeline, and I can't come in to help out because I can't get in early enough for it.
Transportation in the rural area is a real problem. We have been trying for years to attract more and more of our service providers into North Mason, but that becomes a problem when you have organizations with limited resources for them to try to man two offices.
So I went into an office where you could go get help. And so my niece said, well, just go in, Auntie. You know, if you can get on the books, you know, then maybe they'll give you a gas card. I took my pay stubs there in March, because it's April now, and I'm not eligible for any services by $50.
Not living on my own. I need housing. I live in my mom's backyard in a 15-foot trailer, and I can't have any friends come over to her house day or night. They said that if I do, I get kicked out of their property. so I need my own housing bad.
One of the housing barriers here in Mason County, working with the clients that I do, many of them have less than perfect credit. They have backgrounds that are a little spotty. And the lack of people and landlords that are willing to rent to people, even though we have many structures, many houses, many apartments available, people are just not willing to take the risk to give people a second chance to be housed.
Housing's ridiculous. There's so many houses around this town that are empty, sitting for sale, whatever. But people don't want to rent them to the homeless or rent them for a cheap, you know, even if they just rented them for their property taxes. It would pay their property taxes, but they don't want to rent them out. They don't want to put people in, you know, or they want to charge an exuberant amount where there's no way a homeless person could make that amount. And so it's just, they need more housing, they need more social services, I guess. You know, other than just getting food stamps and if you qualify, you know, you have a million kids and you can qualify for cash assistance too. It's ridiculous. The system's just not working.
We lived in a tent for 2 months because my grandma kicked me out when she found out I was pregnant because she didn't want to raise my child too. And of course my dad was still using, I was still using, you know, it was just very chaotic. So definitely her kicking me out and us living in a tent was probably the best thing that ever happened in my life.
The norm is, I haven't got a clue where to go. I don't know what to do. How can I help myself? Because I'm just devastated. And when you're devastated to that degree, there is a time where you just give up. Nobody wants to help you. You don't want to help yourself. Alcohol and drugs play a big part of it because you want to numb yourself to it.
Using this SOS program right now, and I've got a mentor who's really been a big upper in my life.
I'm Sarah, and I'm a mentor for SOS. I mentor Ira. I find it very fulfilling to be a mentor along with my other jobs. I find it also a challenge for single women with no children because it makes it harder for them to find resources. And then a lot of the resources in Mason County are not really known.
I started going to college in 2010, thanks to my counselor at the Harvest Program, who never let me stop going further.
I do have a seasonal job, which is the cold weather shelter here in Shelton. I'm staff 3 nights a week. I have a couple of females that I'm really proud of this year. They've stayed here more and haven't wandered off as much as they used to do, and so they've been doing really good.
We work with people on the level that they are at, and sometimes that takes years. This is not a quick fix.
You have to do this one step at a time. You have to start out from basics. And it's got to be one step at a time to help somebody.
The motto of the city of Shelton is building a stronger community together. And together, we can break the cycle of poverty.